of the 12th Z Jaipur Literature Festival at the Nexa Front Lawn. This session is titled The Theatre of the Political, with guests Shashi Tharoor, Pavan K. Varma, and Sreenivasan Jain. Shashi Tharoor is a prolific writer and popular politician. He has published 18 works of fiction and non-fiction, and is a second-term member of parliament representing Thiruvananthapuram. Pavan K. Varma is the author of a dozen best-selling books, as well as being a diplomat and politician. His latest book is Adi Shankaracharya, Hinduism's Greatest Thinker. And our moderator for this afternoon, Sreenivasan Jain, is the managing editor of NDTV. He currently anchors the award-winning weekly ground reportage and investigative show, Truth Versus Hype. Please join me once again in giving them a warm welcome. This session is presented by Patrika Game Changer Series.
राजस्थान पत्रिका एक सशक्त विपक्ष की भूमिका निभाता है सरकारों की नाराजगी को सहन करना कोई मुश्किल काम नहीं है और पिछले 50 साल में तो कई बार हमने इसको भोगा भी है पाठकों की नाराजगी को सहन करना आसान काम नहीं
Okay, everyone, welcome. Let's get this show on the road. I have either the very daunting or the supremely easy task of moderating a session with Pavan Varma and Shashi Tharoor, who are a lit fest unto themselves. You know, I think it's just literally, they can be like a mobile lit fest. They just go around and then panels form around them. So, I have been given to believe that, like with the IPL, where they present an orange cap to the batsman who scored the most runs or the bowler who's taken the maximum wickets, JLF is thinking of instituting an orange, I'm not sure, pagadi, for whoever has attended the maximum number of panels, which includes book launches and so on. And I think leading the pack right now is Shashi. How many panels have you
done? Are you counting all the years or is it only this one?
Just this one.
This one, I think he has the purple cap or something.
But how many have you done so far?
I've done three so far. This is the fourth.
But that's not counting book launches and whatnot.
They're counting a book launch.
Oh, counting book launch. What about you?
Slightly ahead. This is my fourth session since yesterday and one book launch.
Fourth session, one book launch. Okay. But still two more days to go. So we'll see where we stand on Monday.
Leave tomorrow morning and so does he.
Both of you leave tomorrow morning. So it's a dead heat. My first question to both of you is how your political parties allow you to attend so many lit fests. Isn't there like an HR department in the Congress party which calls you up, Shashi, and says, look, Shashi, you've done Jaipur, you've done Chennai, you can't go to the Bombay lit fest.
Actually, there isn't, but in fact, particularly of late, lit fests have been an extremely useful vehicle for me to advance political ideas.
Right.
My most recent book, The Paradoxical Prime Minister, is an all-out analysis of the 5 years of misgovernance this country has been subjected to. And talking about it underscores the reason why we think this government does not deserve a second chance. Similarly, my previous book, Why I'm a Hindu, lays out Hinduism but also challenges the entire doctrine of Hindutva. So it's very easy for me to make the point that what I'm doing actually advances the interests of the party in front of a thinking audience of people who might not otherwise perhaps be reached through a political rally or a normally political rally.
I see. So he's
also, while I was here yesterday, I did two events for the All India Professionals Congress, which I had.
Okay, so you squeeze the party work.
I haven't been exempt from my party work.
So you're actually campaigning while you're on these panels, sort
that
of.
Too.
Pavan Varma, what about you? Doesn't Nitish Kumar call up and say, Pavan ji, ab chhod dijiye, bahut is saal lit fest ho gaye.
Adi Shankara vaise bhi Kerala se hai.
Nitish Kumar says that those who work for him should be versatile.
Should be?
Versatile.
Versatile, okay.
So I don't think he has a problem. Besides, I think that, you know, this whole business of compartmentalizing or predefining a politician, that he should only do politics 24/7, I think diminishes the politician. There are interests, there are valid ones, and I think literary festivals provide you the platform to articulate not only a literary point of view, but a point of view, which could be congruent with your politics as well. So
fact,
I think
it should be, otherwise you don't have it.
In that sense, and let me add,
politics and ideas.
At least in my case, I don't know about Shashi, I don't need to take permission from anyone.
In fact, Pavan Varma was telling me he's already solved the problem by starting a lit fest in Patna. So he doesn't have to leave his place of work. He can do his lit festing right where he works. So that's one way of getting around it. But, you know, on a more serious note, I think that it is quite remarkable that you have anomalies, and I use this word in the most positive sense, like Shashi Tharoor and like Pavan Varma, who were both career diplomats. Shashi was part of the international bureaucracy. Pavan was part of our IFS here, who left those careers, very successful careers, joined the hurly-burly of Indian politics, but continue to engage with the written word and with literary festivals. They are a rare species. And of course, as Shashi said, his latest book is The Paradoxical Prime Minister. But I really want to make this conversation somewhat about the paradox of Shashi Tharoor and the paradox of Pavan Varma. Shashi, starting with you, that, you know, one of the qualities that you require as a writer is a sense of humor, is a sense of ironic detachment. But it seems to me that those are the first qualities that you have to willingly give up when you join politics. One wrong joke about traveling cattle class and, you know, suddenly everything goes south.
Or rather, dung hits the fan.
Yes, yes. Dung is politically appropriate word. Was that, I mean, how do you retain your sense of humorous or ironic detachment with the world in this sphere where essentially everything is either incredibly good, your leader is amazing, your party is amazing, or incredibly bad? You know, the other side is terrible. There's no space for nuance.
No, in fact, I actually address this in the opening chapter of The Paradoxical Prime Minister. I talk about the fact that there is this Manichaean world, which, by the way, your friends in the media demand of us, where everything has to be black or white, where if one says, even as I, when I said that what Modi said on a particular issue made sense, immediately headlines, Tharoor praises Modi, as if this was something so shocking and scandalous that half my party should be cross with me. So I also partly blame the media for having created a climate of expectation in which the entire business of not having anything good to say about the other side is made to be the default mode. Right. And if you do say something, it's seen somehow as a major transgression or a betrayal or whatever. I personally am of the view that there is a lot to be said for nuance, but we don't do nuance either in our politics or in our media. And after a while, you learn how far you can and cannot go. I mean, frankly, cattle class was the word, the phrase, not only the one that I had known for 30 years in America before coming here, but the phrase used by the questioner. Mm. When the austerity drive was announced, he said, "Mr. Minister, does this mean you will travel cattle class?"
Yeah.
So since he used the question, I assume that it was a familiar phrase in India too.
Yeah.
I'd only just come back, so perhaps I was a little unsighted. And I said, "Yes, I will travel cattle class in solidarity with all our holy cows." And boy, that was when the dung hit the fan. So, you know, very, very quickly stops defending jokes. They don't translate very well into Gujarati and Malayalam and Hindi and so on. But the fact still is that, you know, some humor is necessary for your sanity. You just have to figure out which kind of humor works, which kind of humor you can get away with in a multilingual, intensely political environment.
Pavan Varma, the loss of a sense of humor, the loss of nuance, of irony.
I tell you, Srinivas, I don't think it's necessary. I genuinely believe that you can be in politics and be a human being with a right to what you believe is right to the extent that you don't very dramatically cross party lines. And I can tell you that at least when I'm speaking on television or participating, very often I accept even a criticism of my own point of view Because there's a BBC maxim. You must admit your minor truths in order to have your major lies believed. And I believe genuinely that you can have a far more sane discussion if you are open to criticism, but when you are sure about your point of view. And this brittle polarity that you see in public life, either it's black or it's white, yeah. It's wrong. I think Indian democracy itself needs to mature further to be able to allow the grays to come in, right, without questioning necessarily the ideological fealty of the person who is speaking. Right. I think that's important now because there are overlaps in politics and there could be something which is right from your point of view, but which could genuinely appear to be somewhat less right from another point of view. Now, do you have the courage of conviction to articulate your point of view while accepting that it could be wrong? You see, we've lost the art of civilized dialogue.
Have you ever had that dilemma? Give me an example.
No, I'll tell you frankly. Very often, for instance, in the beginning, when I was unsure, I thought it's best that within the broader party framework of what the party line is, I take the liberty of pushing my neck out to say what I think is right. And even if it's not exactly what the party line is, to bring it in congruence with it while admitting that there is scope for improvement. Now, why can't we do that? It's probably more difficult in the case of Shashi. Mine is a smaller party with a leader who's far more liberal in such matters than perhaps the Congress party. I wouldn't be saying...
No, okay, let me ask you something else, because it's not just a sense of humor or irony that you perhaps, or nuance that you might have to suspend. You also have to suspend ambition. You know, Shashi, you serving under Kofi Annan, you could aspire to run for the office of Secretary General. But serving the Gandhis, you hit a glass ceiling. Or you hit a Gandhi ceiling.
Listen, I mean, it's a question of realism, right? I mean, a political party is a vehicle for the advancement of your ideas and convictions. I believe in the values that the Congress party stands for, and I'm very happy to work in that party.
It's the last session of the evening. Let's have full candor.
No, but part of the realism in that party would be that is no congressman who really would win a free and fair election amongst Congress workers against the current president of the party. It's inconceivable because he is there because the party wants him there. The party workers want him there. And I think one has to acknowledge that and work collectively for the larger goals, the larger values, the larger principles that are at stake in this country.
I'm not disputing the real politic aspect of it or the pragmatic view that you just articulated, that there's nobody would have a chance. I'm just asking you personally, as somebody who I'm sure has ambitions.
Can anybody
isn't that frustrating beyond a point?
Not really, because it depends on how you can. I mean, my ambition in politics is to make a difference. I've tried to make a difference by moving the needle of the national conversation on a number of issues. I've tried to make the difference through my writing and my speeches. Politics has given me a platform to project those ideas and be heard. And at the same time, if I have an opportunity to be in government, there'll be an opportunity to implement in whatever corner of the government I'm given, an opportunity to implement whatever my talent or abilities allow me to implement. So those are my ambitions. Right. I want to serve the country. I want to make a difference. I want people to say, "Isne kuch kiya."
Right.
And ultimately, that is something I'm proud of being able to point to in Trivandrum after 10 years as an MP. And I hope to be able to point to it at the end of my political career. I don't think one can define political ambition in terms of position.
Okay.
One must define political ambition in terms of impact.
Okay, fair enough.
You must understand that when Shashi says, "Usne kuch kiya," he doesn't mean ki usne Rahul Gandhi ko challenge kiya. It doesn't mean that. And it shouldn't mean that necessarily. I mean, if the only touchstone of political courage is to challenge your current leader, I don't think it's either realistic or necessary.
But I want
to mention that, you know, I don't think at the moment that anyone's going to challenge Nitish Kumar in the JDU. I don't think anyone's going to challenge Akhilesh Yadav in the Samajwadi. I don't think anyone's going to challenge Mayawati in the TMC. I don't think anyone's going to challenge Stalin in the DMK. The Shiv Sena, the Thackerays, etc. So the fact is our parties are run that way. And in the BJP, will anyone dare raise a finger against the Modi Shah combined until after they lose in May?
No, it's true. But we're going to get into that in just a second. But, you know, in your case, Pavan, as you said, it is a smaller party, and Nitish Kumar, to his credit, is a diplomat, a Democrat, I beg your pardon, which is actually something I've always been curious to ask you about. I mean, technically, you and Shashi are on opposite sides of the political divide, right? You are part of the ruling coalition, and Shashi is part of the opposition. But on the many occasions that we've heard you speak, including on our platforms, the lines often get blurred. You are a very vocal critic of the BJP government, of the Prime Minister himself, on a number of issues. Doesn't that ever get you into any trouble?
I'll give you a serious answer and an honest one. Not that my other answers were not honest. And this one is this. You see, in a coalition or a gadbandhan,
yes,
each of the constituents have a worldview and a point of view of their own. There is no law by which everyone in an alliance must necessarily ditto what the largest party of that coalition is saying. So there are issues on which we have our own point of view. And I therefore very strongly, for instance, on communalism,
yes,
we have zero tolerance. If there is a BJP leader who makes a communally vitriolic statement, we will condemn it without the slightest hesitation, and I'll be the first person on the line to do so. On the citizenship amendment bill,
yes,
the BJP has one point of view, we have another point of view. On the triple talaq bill, which as brought into parliament now,
yes,
and the process being adopted to rush it through,
yes,
we had another point of view and we said so. There are many issues on which coalition dharma, a phrase that Atal Bihari Vajpayee coined,
yes,
means precisely this, that every member of the constitution of the coalition,
yes,
has the right to differ from the largest
party
in that
coalition.
No, of course
they do. But just two points to that. Number one, it's often not when you say we come out and criticize the BJP on communalism or citizenship. It's often not we. It's often just you, Pavan Varma. You're often the first one out of the gate, and often the only one out of the gate. No. Number two. Let me ask you this. Given that you outlined three fundamental areas where you differ with the BJP, citizenship amendment, communalism, I forgot the third, but these are fundamental issues. Given those differences, is it fair to ask, why are you still with the BJP?
I'll tell you why. Because even if we were to join any other alliance, there could be issues on which we differ from the largest party of that alliance. There's not every issue on which we have congruence with the Congress, although Shashi and I would like it. There are not every issue on which we will be in agreement with the BJP in this case.
No, but that makes it sound like almost a lesser evil sort of argument.
The essential point, Srinivas, is different. The essential point is that we must mature to become a democracy where if you differ, it's not a sign of disloyalty or betrayal,
right,
but it is a matter of principle as well.
Okay.
And that principle must be accepted.
Okay. Shashi.
Well,
yes.
I actually, just to add, yes, anecdotally, that Pavan was at the launch of one of my books, sitting on a panel like this on my immediate left, exactly like this, when he began the panel as my ally in Bihar, and halfway through he showed me his mobile phone.
Right.
Nitish Kumar had just resigned. He said, I've got to go. Halfway through the panel, he disappeared to go off and defend his chief minister on television. So there is, I must say, I respect Pavan a great deal. We're old friends from college days. But sometimes principles do seem to surrender themselves to expediency. I do congratulate Pavan for his courage in saying things that not even his chief minister has said about the coalition ally. But you're quite right in pointing out that those three issues he mentioned, citizenship, triple talaq, and...
triple talaq was the third.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at these issues, they're far more fundamental,
yes,
than any issue that divided the Congress and the JDU.
Yeah.
And yet the JDU abandoned us and left. So it's a very fair question you've asked.
These are to me, would seem like make or break issues,
yeah,
Pavan. But so do you think, I mean, since Pavan may not be able to say it, Shashi, do you think Pavan would personally not like to stay on in the NDA. Personally, he's a bit uncomfortable.
Fortunately, whatever he whispered to me, I didn't hear. Look, I think personally, Pavan and I share a strong faith in a pluralist India, anchored in a healthy respect for ancient Indian traditions, culture, religion, and other values. And at the same time, we believe very much that in today's 21st century India, yes, we cannot have a divisive politics.
Okay.
There, yeah, we are 100% in agreement.
Okay, but you know,
but he has associated himself with a party which is tactically chosen to ally with a party that does not share this principle that I've just described to you at all, which has a totally different vision of India, of Indianness, of Indian politics, of its role in Indian politics. And I must say, I know that some people think that idea of India is a cliche and so on, and that it's been misused. I think the idea of India is very simply derived from the nationalist movement. One bunch of guys said religion should be the determinant of nationhood. That was the idea of Pakistan. They created Pakistan. The other best set of guys, led by Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Maulana Azad, Sardar Patel, the lot, said, no, religion will not be the determinant of nationhood. Our freedom struggle is for everybody, and our country will be for everybody. Yeah. That's what's been reflected in our constitution. Unfortunately, for the first time, we have a party in power that does not buy into that basic consensus.
Okay.
And they're no longer saying that this, I mean, you've actually got a citizenship bill that says fundamentally,
yes,
that you exclude people of one faith and one faith alone, namely Muslims. Now,
this,
to my mind, is precisely why the difference is a fundamental one,
yes,
because it challenges the basic idea of India as reflected in the constitution, as reflected in the country
but when you,
over 70 years.
But when you talk of...
Just let me add. That is why I urged the Congress party, Shashi, not to walk out from the Raj Sabha when the debate comes up. You walked out in the Lok Sabha because there's a brute majority there of the NDA anyway.
Yeah.
But when the bill comes up in the Raj Sabha, by walking out, you will ensure that the bill is passed.
No, I don't think a walkout is on the cards. But equally, I hope the JDU will speak strongly on this issue.
We've already said it publicly.
Very good. Excellent.
But it's not
so
strong.
So convergence of a new kind may be happening.
Yes, at a lit fest. But it's not strong enough, before we move on, it's not strong enough an issue for you to break with them. If they decide to push ahead with it, you will still stay on in the NDA.
So why talk of hypothetical things?
No, I'm asking you.
I believe that what we believe in, we have the fundamental right to voice and where necessary help to change the opinion of that party which does not agree with us.
Okay.
Nothing is written in stone. We've conveyed our point of view to the top BJP leadership and we believe it's wrong for the bill to be passed in the manner in which it has been currently drafted. Now, it's a possibility, and I know that there are some top leaders in the BJP who are doing a rethink on the bill. It's a possibility that our views, our powers of persuasion, or our resoluteness in the matter may change their point of view.
Sure. No, I was asking what if it doesn't. But anyway, that's interesting that you said that top leaders of the BJP are having a rethink on the bill. That's an interesting little piece of news. But you know, when you talk of expediency, Shashi, and you sort of brought that up in the context of the JDU. I mean, the expediency of the Congress, the expediency, some would say, of Shashi Tharoor, hint Shabrimala. Now, tell me honestly, since we're at a lit fest,
just between
us and a couple of 1,000 people. Your U-turn on Shabrimala, was that genuinely your a sort of felt view, or was it just you being politically expedient?
Well, look, I initially welcomed the Supreme Court judgment because it was an intellectual reaction.
Yes.
Intellectual Democrat, liberal, constitutionalist, court says this principle prevails. I said, fine, let's welcome it. In many societies, changes come through the judiciary when Parliament was not prepared to pass the change.
But
I'm also living in the real world. I'm a member of Parliament. I represent 2 million people in the Parliament. And I have to be responsive to their concerns, and I'm accountable to them. So when I started talking to people in the constituency, including a large number of women, I found that for them, this was a visceral assault on something they held intimately precious. For them, this business was not an issue of equality, because equality, they said, we already have. What it's an issue of is sanctity. And the moment you frame the issue as one of equality, there's only one possible answer.
Yes.
We're all for equality.
Yes.
The moment you frame the issue as one of sanctity, then you get into very much more complicated territory.
No, but
because
do you?
For many people,
yes,
the shrine was special because of this rule.
No, I've read your arguments, but again, and I'm sure this is something you've been asked before, and this is something which several people have raised, that isn't this argument of the majority view versus, let's say, the constitutional or the legal principle, exactly the same logic that the BJP advances on an issue like the Ram Mandir? A majority of people felt that actually that there existed a mandir there and that the mosque was an incursion and they tore it down. So how is your take on Sabarimala any different from the BJP's on the Ram Mandir?
There's a difference. The tearing down of the mandir was an act
of the mosque.
An act that was actually a breakdown of law and order, that was an act of criminal vandalism, and to build on that basis is a totally different proposition from looking at a theoretical legal debate in the Supreme Court whether certain practices should be discussed or not.
Even with Sabarimala, there is a law and order aspect to it. Where the same logic, the logic of the majority using force
we don't subscribe
to prevent women from entering the temple.
So we disagree vehemently with that. That's purely the BJP elements, the Sangh Parivar elements, who have been vandalizing police cars, throwing stones at the cops, obstructing the women, and frankly, needled deliberately by the state government, which is even putting helmets and flak jackets on women to go into the temple, sneaking two women in through a side entrance. Yeah. Just to finish, there is a political agenda here. As a politician, let me not be oblivious to the politics of this. For the CPM, the objective is the same as the BJP's polarized opinion, so that Congress Hindu votes go to the BJP, and that way the left will win. That's their whole logic. And for the BJP, polarization is part of their agenda anyway. So for them, they too had to do a U-turn. The BJP was on record, so much so that on the day of the Supreme Court judgment, the day they announced their protests, their party newspaper carried an editorial praising the judge.
I know.
So everyone is doing U-turns because for people it's fundamental. It's very interesting
to
mention Ram Mandir, because a Muslim League politician said to me that he, having spoken to Hindus, understood that this was the equivalent for people of what he felt when the Babri Masjid was torn down.
Okay, once
that's
again,
the
Pavan,
level of assault people feel on their
Okay, we could keep going. Pavan, you wanted to come in.
I understand where Shashi is coming from. He has to fight the next election. And even if you don't agree with what perhaps the largest number of your constituents are saying, sometimes it's difficult not to be empathetic to what they are saying. On the other hand, we are very clear that the Supreme Court judgment outlines the right principle. When untouchability was abolished in this country, the same Hindu lobbies protested.
Exactly.
Quoting from scripture that this is against the ordained law of their personal law. When, for instance, the Hindu Civil Code was introduced, there were the same protests, and it was judicial opinion and legislative opinion that overruled what was a primeval and medieval mindset. Today, I believe strongly, Shashi, that the balance of equity is on the favor of gender equality, and that women have equal rights to enter a temple, and that the issue of equality outweighs the simulated issue of tradition. Now, that's my personal belief, but I will not hold you necessarily on an inquisitorial chair on this matter.
I want to move beyond Sabarimala.
Just to say that, I have a blemishless spot record on issues of women's equality, social advancement of marginalized groups, and so on. So I don't think that I'm a paragon of conservative tradition. The problem is, when you start applying this principle to religion, you do transgress an area that's beyond rational debate. For example, there are temples where men are not allowed into the
sanctuary. That's Amit Shah's argument, for God's sake.
No, but it's true. It's true.
But
Shashi,
that's... No.
They need to change as well. You cannot quote one thing that is wrong
by
quoting a precedent of the other.
But the problem is, you're saying that all temples should be open to both genders, all genders.
I think so, because all these religious...
But then the whole rationale of the temple disappears. For example, there is a temple to Kanya Devi in Kanyakumari, where in the sanctum sanctorum, man cannot step in because it's meant to be the virgin goddess. She should not behold a man. Now, the moment a man steps in and pursuance of Pavan's principle, Shashi, she spoils the temple. He spoils the temple for lacks of women devotees.
That's false equivalence, though. It's different when it comes to women. You know that. We have a gender... Because there is a problem with a society, in a patriarchal society like India. There are issues about women's access, women's entry. And so this is a very... to say that there are men's temples where men are not allowed is a thin end of the wedge. But let me ask you a different question before we move on from Shabrimala, which is that... The Congress seems to have taken a very curious position that on one hand, you feel that you also want to respect the faith of the majority, but you also have taken the constitutional position that you believe that you also will stand by the Constitution. I haven't been able to understand how that would actually work on the ground, because the courts have clearly said that women need to be allowed.
But there's a review petition pending.
There's a review petition, but at the moment, the order still stands. Were you to have been in the Chief Minister's gaddi, what would you have done? How would you have gone about implementing the court's order?
It's a very interesting question, because we already have an answer from the same state government, the same chief minister, in the case of another Supreme Court judgment involving two factions of the Orthodox and Jacobite churches, which the government has gone out of its way to not implement because they don't want to antagonize either voting banks.
But on Shabrimala, how?
So we know that there is a political calculation behind a decision not to implement, and there is a political calculation behind a decision to implement. I'll tell you what I would have done, because I've written it. I would have called a meeting of all stakeholders. I would have said, this is the situation we are confronted with. I need your cooperation. How do we work this forward? What's the way we should do it? Are there practical arrangements? What do you intend to do? No effort was made to consult.
The state government claims they've done that. They said that they sat down
very much
with all the stakeholders.
After the incidents had happened.
Okay.
Let's move on.
There are specific aspects of the case also that you must take into account. In the case of Sabrimala, women devotees were of a certain age entering the temple till 20 years ago.
Yes.
So we need to
move beyond Shabrimala. I want to ask both of you this as we sort of wind down on time, about what all of this has meant in terms of the conversations we're having these days about going back to your point about the idea of India and about the sense that somewhere along the line, the consensus on what secular politics meant has shifted. Whether we like it or not, that is a reality. There appears to be a middle, a broadly moderate centrist Hindu middle that has tilted rightwards. And this is a shift that we're seeing the world over. What is the solution, or what's the way in which professedly liberal secular parties like the ones to both of you belong can actually try to bring this middle back without recoursing to a sort of Me Too majoritarianism, which some are accusing the Congress, for instance, of doing?
I don't think that you have to
bring them back.
A Me Too majoritarianism or a soft Hindutva or an appeasement of Hindutva in order to bring sanity back to the debate on secularism in this country. India is a plural country. It's a country which has many faiths, and the basic principle on which our nation is constituted is respect for all faiths that are in this country.
But isn't that exactly what the Congress is doing?
I want to add to that. There was a perception in this country that there was, on the other hand, an appeasement of minority votes for vote bank politics. And it all began, Shashi, frankly, if you ask me, with the Shabano judgment, where I believe the ruling of the Supreme Court was overruled by an ordinance on entirely misguided advice. And from then onward, there has been, over a period of time, a sense and a perception that there is a certain kind of appeasement politics being played with minorities, perhaps exaggerated very often for political reasons, but nevertheless a perception. That appeasement of minority votes for vote bank politics. I think there's a backlash against this also.
Yes, but my question is, what's the corrective?
There's an appeasement of a majority now.
Yeah, there's majority appeasement now, which I'm sorry to say that even so-called liberal parties like the Congress are doing. Do you agree with that? Do you agree with this Janayudhari, Shiv Bhakt, new chehra of the Congress?
Now see, I think that in our country, to be able to say in public that you are religious does not mean that you are medieval or primitive. I mean, what is this hypocrisy about? We are a country of many faiths. We profess ourselves to be under the constitution. We respect all faiths. But if I have a personal faith and I visit a temple, and if it's somebody from the Congress that visits it, it becomes soft Hindutva, whereas everybody else can go to any temple they want whenever they wish to.
But Pavan,
so what's wrong with that?
Come on, Pavan, these are not private visits. These are highly publicized election time visits. And they've only spiked in the past 4.5 years.
Election time is when... Election time is when...
It's not consistent with the party's political behavior at all.
You know,
that's not true.
Vasu, election time is when you need spiritual help the most.
Ah, right. Okay.
Well said, Pavan.
Because we've debated this on occasion, but I'm just going to ask you a different question. Do you think that this sort of reformatted avatar of the Congress is helping you? Is it helping shake off what Sonia Gandhi admitted, that the BJP had successfully managed to paint you as a Muslim party?
No, look, I mean...
Is it helping?
We are definitely neutralizing the attempt to parody what the Congress stands for. And I think there's no question that this has nothing to do with Hindutva. Hinduism is an inclusive faith. Hindutva is an exclusionary political doctrine, and the two have nothing in common. Therefore, when we go to temples, it is in the worship of an inclusive faith, resting on the cardinal principle of the acceptance of difference. Just as we have multiple forms and ways of worshiping God, so also we accept other religions' worship of God. So as far as we are concerned, we don't think we are subscribing in any way to soft Hindutva, and I want to reject that charge ultimately. The political purpose, however,
yes,
of making clear publicly, as you asked, what hitherto we had considered unseemly to talk about publicly,
yes,
the reason for doing that is to neutralize the BJP's rather insidious argument that they're the only party.
But you know, in the process, I feel that Muslims have been invisibilized by political parties in a way that, at least in my 20 years of journalism, I've never seen. So it's not just one or the other. It has actually been one at the cost of the other. I'll give you a small example. 37 people have been killed, murdered in cow lynching since this government has come to power, compared to virtually negligible, that figure was negligible under UPA 2. How many?
97% of all cow lynchings,
yes,
since 1947 have occurred in the last 4.5 years, according to the Ministry of Home Affairs.
Please. Yes. So, and tell me, how many of those victims has Rahul Gandhi visited, of those 37 lynchings?
I don't know offhand.
I can tell you.
He certainly, in every case, the Congress has condemned these incidents.
I can tell you, one, compared to how many temples has Rahul Gandhi visited in the past 4.5 years? That's what I'm talking about.
I guess it depends on who invites you during an election campaign. Look, I have contested 2 elections now, looking forward to a third, and in every one I have been to churches, mosques, and temples all the time, even before the media started noticing.
Right.
The truth is, that's part of the culture of the place. We go, but we only go where we're welcome. No one walks into a place of worship uninvited or in a disrespectful manner. And I think for Rahul Gandhi to go to a temple as part of a campaign is the way in which you seek the blessings. I mean, I've seen drivers on national highways, you know, paying obeisance at a mandir before they embark. And in one case, it was a Muslim driver doing it.
No, no.
Simply was a cultural tradition.
No one is disputing that we're a devout country and that, you know, everyone from a driver to a Rahul Gandhi is devout. It's just whether it's tactical, is it cynical, is it expedient. But before we go to questions, because we're hitting the 15-minute mark, quickly, predictions from both of you. This is, you know why? This is actually to help me, because this is a question that journalists, and I'm sure, you know, people like yourself get asked all the time. Give us your 2019 prediction. So, come on, Pavan. Let's have it.
My genuine feeling is that the NDA will emerge as the single largest political grouping.
Come on, Pavan. Okay, that's the official response. Let's have the JLF asli response.
And the NDA is not single anyway. It's multiple, as we've just said.
Right.
So this is what I believe, that although there will be an erosion of seats from what the BJP got in 2014, and that erosion, the figure can vary, but it will be certainly significant. The BJP will emerge as the single largest party.
Yes.
And the NDA as a political grouping will be the largest grouping in the country post 2019 elections. This is what it appears as of now. So it will be a very different kind of government that could be formed. And I don't want to predict elections, and this should not be written in stone, and I should be not be quoted on it.
It's already on Twitter. It's gone viral. But I just want to ask you before I come to Shashi, when you say it's going to be a very different coalition, what are we to read into that? Is it a given that Mr. Modi will continue to lead this coalition if the BJP, as you said, has significantly dwindled its numbers? Or will the NDA constituents have a say in determining who gets to be the Prime Minister?
Well, I think the single largest party in a coalition, if it elects the leader or nominates the leader, I think the rest of the constituents will need to consult and decide. But as of now, I don't see what's the challenge to Mr. Narendra Modi from either within the BJP, and none of the NDA allies have said that there's another leader who should come and take his place. So, I mean, this is truly hypothetical.
Not publicly, at least.
No, I mean, there could be people who are possibly waiting in the wings within the BJP. But that's another matter. Right now, there's no challenge to Mr. Modi as the unquestioned leader of the BJP.
Okay. Shashi, prediction?
My prediction is, number one, I disagree with Pavan. I think the BJP will lose half the seats it won in 2014. But second, I want to say that even if Pavan turns out to be right and the BJP has more seats than anybody else, they still will not form the government because they will not be able to find the allies that the Congress party and a potential UPA 3 would find.
Give me a number.
No, there's no point because honestly, I smashed my crystal ball on the way over. And
No, because, you know, I try to give the same spiel whenever someone asks me and no one is interested. They want numbers. Do you? Why don't you risk a number?
I'll give you numbers 3 months down the line.
Oh, wonderful. That's that's a big help. Okay, questions. My gosh, it's a bit dark. So can we have some lights on the audience? Is that possible at all? No.
Or maybe get someone to go with mics to the audience.
Let me as always try to start from the back because that's what politics is all about, to reach the akhri.
The dark
aurat. Can we go to the lady in the red jacket over there? Yes. And questions, please, not statements. And let's try and be brief.
Good evening, sir. My question is for Mr. Shashi Tharoor, sir. Mm-hmm. Sir, I'm a huge fan, first of all.
Thank you.
And I want to know which are some of the books that you believe have shaped a huge part of who you are as a person, and also that help you cope with the political vaudeville.
Okay, well, I have to name too many for a reasonably short answer.
Yeah.
One, definitely the Mahabharata, because it really gives you the most extraordinary insights into human nature and character. Yeah, I would dare to call it a secular epic because the only divine figure really is Krishna. Otherwise, you've got extraordinarily interesting people, heroes with feet of clay, motivated by many of the base motivations in politics, lust and greed and ambition and jealousy, and all of those are fully on display. And at the same time, the stories are compelling, the philosophies woven into it is compelling, and I would agree that there really isn't another single work which offers as much to the Indian reader as the Mahabharata does. And if I were to take a second book, even though there will be more than those, a second book I think that I would recommend to you in terms of what has impacted me in my vision of politics in India would be Jawaharlal Nehru's The Discovery of India.
Okay.
It's an extremely well-written book, written in fact in jail without the benefit of much research material or references, and yet imbued with a great vision, a humane vision of Indian history, Indian culture, Indian civilization, and the urgent priorities of Indian politics. So those two I would recommend to you in two very different ways.
Not exam warriors?
I mean, exam warriors should be written by somebody who's done very well in the school and college exams, right?
All right. Okay, let's see. Yes, can we go to the lady here? Right, yes, that's yes.
Good evening, sir. My question is for Mr. Tharoor, sir. Yesterday, you quoted and said that Tharoorism came into being and you felt that you needed to use it for the good, for the benefit, to actually, you know, kind of progress the English knowledge and vocabulary of the people around. Your personal conviction was that. At the same time, you say that you would want to be a catalyst of change. Don't you think, on a political level, we can understand that you have to be a diplomat and a Democrat, but on a personal level, don't you think that you need to be a catalyst of change in your party on the nepotism that has brewed for so many years at the head of it? And that you, when you can use Tharoorism to influence so many people to gain a better vocabulary, you can influence, certainly influence your party to kind of break away from the nepotism and get someone better in picture for the coming election.
Oops. Oh, shit.
That's a planted question, Vasu. You did it.
Well, I mean,
no,
people are everywhere.
I think if you were there yesterday, you heard me saying already yesterday that genuinely, Rahul Gandhi remains the choice of the party and the most popular leader in the party. You know, of the party. Look, every political party is a vehicle, party workers do. But I urge you all to also understand, I'm saying a little more than I said yesterday, that there really is a very unfair portrayal of Rahul Gandhi that lies behind many of the questions and concerns of those who made that noise. I actually have known the person. We've been in parliament together. I've talked to him on multiple occasions. This is not the kind of person he's been effectively caricatured by the BJP as being. He is smart. He is thoughtful. He's amazingly well-read. Honestly, now, see, but that laughter shows you that the caricatures is what's actually prevailed in people's minds.
Okay,
this is somebody who in many ways has also demonstrated his connect to the people. And he personally led the campaign in all the five states and the three that the BJP were ruling, the Congress is now ruling. So this is somebody with genuine mass connect and genuine popular appeal. Give him a chance. I'm sure we won't disappoint you.
Convinced? Not convinced. Okay. Anyway, good attempt. Any questions for Pavan Varma? Because there must be... yes? Questions for Pavan Varma? Yes? Okay. Yes.
My question is to both the panelists, including Mr. Pavan Varma. We have had a paradoxical prime minister. We have had an accidental prime minister. When do we have an author who turns into a prime minister?
When do we have an author who turns into a prime minister? I mean, Nehru was an author.
Nehru was a very good author.
We've had an author who was a prime minister in the form of Jawaharlal Nehru. And sometimes you have to wait for good things to happen.
I can tell you this, that if literary festivals had the casting vote, Shashi Tharoor would be prime minister and Pavan Varma would be finance minister. Or the other way around. So, deputy prime minister. Okay. Yes. Lady at the back. Yes. In the middle. Yes.
Good evening, sir. My question is to Mr. Tharoor. Sir, as you keep saying that people, the youth in India is literate but not educated. So what if the Congress comes in power in the next coming elections? So what would be the reforms that would be there in the education system?
Well, there's absolutely no doubt that the need for reform is urgent. We do need to focus much more on learning outcomes than on process. We've spent far too much time on regulations. By the time you get to college, for example, the UGC is busy writing to universities saying how many classrooms they must have, what size the classrooms must be. In schools, they're told what size their playgrounds must have. This kind of thing is foolish. What we really ought to be focusing on is to move a system that is at the moment over-regulated and under-governed into one that emphasizes heavily on quality, that draws from the contemporary research and understanding of what is the best way to promote quality within the constraints of our economics and our resources. And at the same time, when you get to higher levels, ensure that the mismatch between the academic world and the industrial world disappears. Right now, I mean, one small reform we introduced was to polytechnics, where we said that we will not give permission to any polytechnic to open in India unless it has an affiliation to an industry within a 30-kilometer radius of that polytechnic. That no one talked about it at that time, but it was a very important step, because there's no point sending kids to polytechnics where teachers are teaching them things that are 30 years out of date from when they learned. And when they go looking for a real job, people say, your skills don't match what we need. So we need to actually orient all of this. There's a very good report from Narayana Murthy, the Infosys man, on academia-industry interface, which I would certainly, it was done just before we finished our term of office. The BJP has let it gather dust on the shelves. We need to do that. And I think we need to do a very time-bound education commission. The Kothari Commission, which studied all of India's education, is 1969. We really need to rethink everything from top to bottom. You're quite right. Without doing that, we will not be able to salvage the hopes of the young generation for the demographic dividend the country wants.
Okay, yes. Let's try and go a little further back. Do we have mics at the back there? There's someone who has their hand up. Okay, yes.
Thank you. And warm good evening, all of you. And firstly, when it's about two gentlemen, so, and I just want to declare this, I'm apolitical. And I'll ask something personal. If you may, you can answer or not. I'm a great fan, and two of you are very relatable. So I just want to ask, if you had to take a choice, so what would it be? This is to both of you gentlemen, that be a writer or being a politician. So what is your pick? And this is to both of you. Thank you very much.
What's your choice if you were to pick to be a writer or a politician? I mean, right now, you're both. So, I don't know.
Should I go first?
Sure.
No, I mean, I really don't think there's a contradiction between the two. In fact, I think each of these two areas of interest reinforce the other. I don't think we have space or need anymore for politicians who don't think, read and write. This country must change. There has to be the reflexive quality of analysis and contemplation and reflection, what is called in our shastras as Shravan, Manan, Mimansh. This is important. So I have never seen the two in conflict, and from my point of view, they should, and in my case at least, they go together.
What? Can I just ask?
I mean, in all fairness, you know, you're the same human being, right? So you react to the world you see around you. You express the thoughts that you feel, some of which you do as a politician, some of which you do as a writer. But I will make a choice since you've said it. I know that politics ultimately is more transient than good writing. I'm already a former minister. One day I might be a foreigner MP. And if some people have their way, it'll be sooner rather than later. But I hope never to be a former writer.
Can I ask both of you, of writing or politics, which is commercially more lucrative?
Well, certainly for me, I mean, the only growth I've seen in my assets is my savings from my international days growing in terms of Mr. Modi's depreciation of our currency.
Right.
What used to be converted when I first came at 40-something rupees is now being converted at 70.
Oh
so my
God,
assets seem larger.
But I like actually, how you made that also into
in
a
politics
political.
As an MP, I earn 50,000 rupees a month salary, and my monthly expenses are closer to 2 lakhs.
I need to
meet my basic expenses
run
an office in Delhi, run an office in my constituency.
I was just
it's not
I
lucrative
was,
at all. Writing is what helps me survive in politics.
I know. But I'll be honest with you.
I haven't earned a rupee in politics, but I do earn a little in writing.
Okay. All right. We have just time for a few more questions. Yes. Gentleman there with the glasses.
Hello. All right. A very good evening. My question is to Mr. Shashi Tharoor. I'm going to use the metaphor which you used in the Oxford Union debate, where you said Indians missed the bus. So I'll draw a parallel. The weakest sections missed the bus for globalization. They missed the bus. In USA, they have elected a very conservative government. We see that in Brexit as well. So, but Modi ji, Mr. Modi ji, the Prime Minister and the current government has worked a lot on financial inclusion, cyber inclusion and all that. The question is, in 2019, If we go with the Congress, are we also going to see a conservative government which do not work on financial inclusion or cyber inclusion, which the current government has done?
No, I'm not sure I heard every word of your question clearly, but if I got the general thrust of it right, my answer would be that A, we didn't, the weaker sections in our society did not suffer from globalization the way the working class in the Western world did. Their jobs were exported to Shanghai. In our case, every year during UPA's 10-year term, every year we pull 10 million people out from below the poverty line. And this communist cliche that the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer The actual truth is the rich did get richer, but the poor also got less poor, got richer, in fact. And that transformation means that our weaker sections became less weak. You just look at the BPL statistics, below the poverty line statistics, have been a steady drop every year for a decade. It hasn't done so well in the last 4.5 years. But my answer to you is that certainly the Congress, if it comes to power, is going to gain from using the accumulated expertise and experience that it's had for all these years of governance. And we do have very progressive ideas. You'd be interested to know, we're working on a manifesto right now, and we've invited suggestions from the entire thinking public, manifesto@inc.in. Just send us your suggestions. And when that manifesto comes out, it'll also be informed by some very serious studies that are being done by within the party on issues of the jobs crisis, the agriculture crisis, and the overall economy. So you'll see some very well-founded proposals backed up on our website when we come to the nation with our manifesto.
Okay. The clock has hit zero, but I'm told we just are able to take a few more questions. Can we have that? Yes, the lady over here. Let's again keep the questions brief, and my request to both my eminent panelists is answers brief as well, so we can squeeze in a few more questions.
The question is to the both of you, and it's not a political one. We talked a lot about gender equality when it comes to Sabarimala. I want to know your thoughts about the conversation started by the Me Too movement and about the marital rape conversation going on in the country recently.
Well, I've expressed my views on this already, so I'll just repeat them very briefly. On Me Too, I think the problem is not just creepy sexual behavior. It's the exploitation of a power differential. If you look at the various cases that have come up, it's editors harassing journalists, it's producers or directors harassing actors, it's employers harassing employees, and that power differential is what makes it particularly, to me, something that is condemnable and action should be taken against. So I stand in solidarity with the Me Too movement for that reason also. Secondly, on marital rape, I've actually introduced a bill in Parliament that would criminalize marital rape. As I said when I disagreed with Menaka Gandhi's revised stand on the subject, where she said that we can't criminalize marital rape because it's against Indian culture, I said, what is this business of Indian culture? Rape is not about sex, it's about violence. And it's violence and force that we should be standing against. You don't know the number of cases that one reads about where estranged husbands have gone and raped their wives, their estranged, separated wives, and cannot be prosecuted because under the law, a marital rape is not an offense.
Let's get Pavan Diol, because the question was to both of you. Very briefly,
I think the Me Too movement has empowered women to speak out against what is obviously exploitation and very often done by those who are in a position of power. And I think to that extent, it has certainly put men on their guard against this kind of behavior, and therefore I give it full support. As far as marital rape is concerned, we support the principle, but we'd like to see a more detailed bill on it where all contingencies can be taken into account, and we have a bill that can be implemented in a manner which really brings relief to women effectively.
You have a union minister who's faced multiple charges of Me Too, who had to step down, but he's being resurrected by the party of which you're an ally.
I don't know how he's being resurrected, and if he is, I don't believe it's the right thing to do.
Okay. Absolutely, the last question. Yes, the lady over there.
Hello. My question is for both of you. Sir, you said that your favorite book is Mahabharata, and I attended your session of Finding Radha. I know that both of you relate with Mahabharata in a way. So, in this theater of politics, which character of Mahabharata do both of you identify with?
Without doubt, in my case, it's Krishna.
I have to confess, as the author of the great Indian novel, it has to be Vedvyas, because I love telling the story and also playing a role in it once in a while, and then coming out and continuing to tell the story.
Who would Modi be in the Mahabharata?
My fear is that he's Dushasan, disrobing our democracy.
Pavan?
No comment.
Okay. Thank you all very much. Ladies and gentlemen, Shashi Tharoor, Pavan Varma. Thank you. And you've been a fantastic audience as well.